This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. This is Whitley Strieber. Today we are going to explore in depth the Pascagoula UFO incident. I have on the line, here in the U.S., Calvin Parker himself, who had the experience, and from Greece, Stephanos Panayotakis. And the three of them are going to tell the following stories. First, Philip is going to set the scene for us. What happened? When did it happen? Why is it so important? Why is this extraordinary book that he's published about it doing so fabulously all over the world? Then we're going to hear from Calvin. What was it like? Because it's a truly extraordinary experience, one of the early close encounter experiences, and also one of the best. And then Stephanos has got a remarkable story to add, which we will hear later on. Philip, let's start. Why don't you set the scene for us?
Absolutely. Good evening, Whitley. The scene is the Pascagoula River, Mississippi, USA, October the 11th, 1973. Two gentlemen, Charles Hickson, who was 42, and his young companion, Calvin Parker, was 18 at the time. And they both worked together. They'd not been working together long. Calvin was a friend of the family, and they decided that evening, pretty much like he does now, to go fishing. They love to fish. So on the way back from work, they were looking up a few spots on the Pascagoula River. So later that day, you know, they did as planned. At the Shorepeter shipyard on the river, it's not an out-of-the-way place as far as UFO incidents are concerned. There's a Highway 90 there. There's a bridge goes over the river. And driving into the place where they were going to fish, there was a sign saying, don't go any further. But they did. So anyway, you know, they started to fish. It hadn't been a great night for fishing. And, you know, I think both of them were thinking about it's maybe time to go home, but I'll have one last try. Ever the optimist, the fisherman, when, it's not sure who exactly noticed first, but there were some blue lights. Now, Calvin thought, it's the police. You know, he remembered the no entry sign on the way in. And he thought, you know, it was the police coming to move them on. But when they turned around and looked, it was certainly no police car. A strange-looking object that looked like an American football was descending. And it didn't quite touch the ground. It stayed a couple of feet off the ground. Naturally, these two men were amazed. I believe Calvin's first thought was, let me get out of here, but this thing was blocking their way and there was the river behind them, so there was nowhere to run. And then out of nowhere, there was an opening on this craft, we'll call it, and out literally floated three humanoid beings. Again, like the craft itself, they didn't touch the ground, were a couple of feet off the ground. They were gray in color, about average height. No eyes, no nose. They had protrusions sticking out of the side of the head and the front of their face. And their hands were like mittens or pincers. Their legs never moved. And they floated towards Charlie and Calvin, literally took hold of them, took them on board this craft. I'm telling a long story very shortly.
Yeah, well, here. Philip, what I want to do now is I want to do this a little differently. I want Calvin to tell this story. What I want you to do is to tell what happened afterwards. When they went public with it, and why it, and how it is that you became so interested in it.
Well, yeah, I mean, it went public overnight. I mean, literally, there was a media scrum. The late Dr. Alan Hynek was on site within no time. They'd reported it to the sheriff's department. Within 2 days, they'd been interviewed at Keesler Air Force Base. And the story literally spread around the world. Now, this was 1973.
But you know something interesting? Now, if the same thing happened, this story wouldn't go anywhere. Anywhere. It would be ignored.
Well, that's debatable. Today we have, you know, the internet and so on, but this story did go around the world. There was nothing like it. And my interest began in the 1980s, because there was no internet in those days, as we all know, Whitley, the old-fashioned way of reading things, you know, books.
Yeah.
So I read about these two gentlemen, and it was fascinating. But it remained there. It was one of those incidents that stuck in my mind for whatever reason. I think, first of all, the fact that the two gentlemen were so sincere, and the fact that there were two of them as well, not just one. The creatures they observed were very peculiar. The way they went about reporting it was unique to the police, to the Air Force, and so on. And Alan Hynek had passed away, but he gave it its seal of approval. So my way of thinking in those days, well, if it was good enough for Dr. Hynek, it's good enough for me. So we moved forward in time up to last year, and I'd obtained the rights to publish. I run a small publishing outfit called Flying Disc Press. It's just me, to publish Charlie Hickson's book that he did with a chap called William Mendes in 1983. So I republished it, and while I was doing that, I thought, well, I know Charles Hickson sadly had passed away in 2011. I wondered if it perhaps Calvin Parker was still around. I was looking for an interview, nothing more. And amazingly, Whitley, nobody had a clue. I even contacted a well-known UFO group in Mississippi. They'd never even heard of the incident. They sent me a number of links to the internet, which I was not looking for that. However, I found out that Calvin had done a podcast interview back in 2013, I believe it was, because it was the anniversary date. And luckily enough, I knew the gentleman that did the podcast. He still had Calvin's email address. So I sent it. It didn't come back. And eventually, we spoke on the telephone, and it was just by pure coincidence and chance that when I spoke to Calvin, he said, well, I've been thinking about doing my own book, Philip. Bear in mind, all I was looking for was an interview. So over the next few months, we passed ideas backwards and forwards on the phone or via email. And eventually, you know, Calvin Parker's Pascagoula, The Closest Encounter, my story was published earlier this year, and to our delight and surprise, I might add, it has sold very well and became a bestseller on Amazon. And it is, you know, as astounded as both. So that's how it came about, quite by chance, Whitley, really.
Well, it's quite remarkable. So you basically, what you did was you went for it.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, yeah. You know... I work at this full time now. I don't have a day job anymore. So
now this tends, you know, to be definitely a night job, doesn't it?
Well, yeah, using day job in a roundabout way, but I don't have a 9-to-5. Right? You know, this is what I do for a living now. But it was just out of interest. I mean, you know, it was one of those cases. I felt honored to speak to Calvin. When I spoke to him on the phone, he still finds that rather peculiar, but you know, I felt, you know, and I was just fascinated to learn more. And as we spoke, I did learn more. I still learn more every time I speak to Calvin. He has led a full life outside of the UFO incident, of course. And so it one of those stories that continued to fascinate me. And, you know, once the book was published, Whitley, every day something new was happening. You know, people were contacting us, said, well, you know, I was a witness possibly to this event. Or, you know, I remember one remark said, well, I remember the event back in 1973 and I didn't believe it. But when I heard Calvin Parker talk about his story, now I do. So, here's me looking for an interview, and I ended up with a best-selling book instead.
I came to this myself. We're going to take a break in just a moment, and when we get back, we're going to be talking to Calvin and then later Stefanos about the incident itself. But I remember also back in the 80s, after I had my own close encounter of the third kind, I began to look into the literature, and I found this story, And I found it extremely compelling. At the time, I wasn't involved in interviewing people and so on and so forth, but it was rather chilling to see the descriptions of the beings because they were very familiar to me from my own life. So I never was a doubter at all. Now, Free Dreamlanders, we're going to take a brief break. And as always, until we get the new site rolling, you will be have the whole show available to you. We'll be right back. We're talking to Calvin Parker about his extraordinary close encounter experience in Mississippi back in 1973. Philip Mantle, the publisher of Flying Disc Press, and the new book, My Story by Calvin Parker, remarkable new vision of this experience. And also Stephanos Panayotakis from Greece, who will tell us about another witness to this who has never been discovered before. It's quite a new discovery. Flyingdiscpress.blogspot.com. You can get all of Philip Mantle's extraordinary books from Flying Disc Press or go on Amazon or wherever books are sold. You can get My Story by Calvin Parker, very well worth your time. Calvin, can you first just tell us your story, and then we're going to get into it a little bit more in depth. But what happened on that night? You guys were fishing. It's a perfectly innocent thing to be doing. Where were you, and what was it like at that moment?
We was in a little town called Pascagoula, Mississippi, and it was probably getting close to late evening because we had just got off work and it was a hot day. I mean, so instead of going home, we decided to go do a little bit of fishing. So we went home, got Charlie's fishing equipment because I didn't have none down. So I borrowed his thing, some of his, and we rode to a place that he liked to fish. I never had fish there. It's called a grain elevator, but it's the old Shaw Peters shipyard where they used to unload grain. And grain would fall off this grain elevator into the water, and the fish would come up and eat it. And he said he always had real good luck there. And I know he did because Charlie was a good fisherman. So we left and went, and to set the stage, when we got to the area that it was, if y'all know what marsh grass is, it was probably, during October, it's at full growth, about 6-8 foot tall. And just starting to kind of die off a little bit. And we parked up on the road, and there was a no trespassing sign, but there was so much debris down through there. I asked Charlie, I said, they don't care about this property. Why don't they keep it picked up? So Charlie had told me that, and later on I found out this is true, that when the water gets up, and it's tidal water here, and when you get a little storm surge, it comes in over the land. And then when it goes out, it leaves the debris that it brought in. But it brings everybody's houses is built up. It brings everything out from under their house, and it floats down the river and all the logs and all. And it deposited it up on the ground. And then the tide will go out and leave it. So to set the stage, it was a hard time getting that 100 yards from my car down to the pier where we fished. So we struggled, and we got down, and we sat down on the pier for a minute, got situated and cast out. And I was sitting there looking across the river at another old boat that was parked over, a Coast Guard boat or no NOAA boat. And I was thinking in my mind, how in the world does something made out of steel float like this? And I just couldn't even dream it. Even though I was building ships, I still didn't understand the physics of something floating that was built out of steel. And that's when I noticed the blue lights coming across from behind me, reflecting out across the water. And it got my attention because the first thing I noticed was a no trespassing sign to where we had got. And I figured, you know, Charlie is going to get us in jail. He led me off down here. I don't know this place. We walked through this mess. Now I'm going to have to go to jail and miss supper. But Needless to say, I wish that's what it had been. So we stood up and turned around almost at the same time when we noticed them lights. And then all of a sudden, the blue lights just kind of faded out, and the brightest light you could ever imagine in your life. It was so bright, it was blinding, just hit us in the face, and it kind of temporarily blinded us for just a minute. Now, I'm speaking for myself. I can't speak for Charlie because, you know, he's not here. But this light was so bright that it temporarily blinded us, and when it kind of faded off, it was too late to run or anything because it was three robotic-looking creatures almost to us. And, I mean, they was floating over the top of that marsh grass and just coming over the top of the junk that was down there. That's how fast they was moving at 300 yards. They was on us before we knew it. So I kind of looked to the left and the right, and behind me I knew it was water, and you couldn't jump off in it because there's all kind of debris in it. But I kind of dodged in behind Charlie a little bit, thinking, well, if there's trouble, I'm going to let him deal with it. So, and he did. We did. Two of these creatures got a hold of Charlie. And that's actually kind of the last I seen of him for a minute. You would think that it'd be in front of me, but one of them got a hold of myself, and I felt I heard a little wisp of air when he got a hold of me, and I figured that was a tranquilizer or something because I couldn't turn my...
Let me just ask you a little bit about that wisp of air. Where did it come? Where did it hit you? How did you feel?
You could feel when it first immediately happened, you could feel a little sting in my arm. And later on, when I went to the hospital to get checked out, you know, my arm was ripped and it was a puncture mark there. So that's why I'm figuring it was a tranquilizer, because I went from being just morbidly afraid to relaxed. Now, I couldn't turn my head. I couldn't move my arms or my legs or anything. I was conscious of everything going on. And my eyes worked good. I could see straight in front of me. And the only way I could see from side to side is just kind of roll my eyes from side to side. And that's what happened. You know, I got relaxed, and I was facing the craft then, and I heard the little air and the tranquilizer, what I'm saying is a tranquilizer. So, and we just scooted, I mean, right up to the front of the craft. And it was amazing just kind of floating over all that. And the first thing I thought, well, why didn't this break my arm or something the way he picked me up? I wasn't very big back then, 160 pounds. But, you know, you pick somebody up with one hand by the arm, you should feel a great amount of pain, or it should break a bone or something. And I never could understand that.
So you were literally, were you physically picked up and lifted?
I was physically picked up and lifted. But when this happened, I didn't feel the pain, and it just kind of effortlessly, you know, it just like I floated up.
Did you feel light, like floating, lightweight?
I did.
So did I. That's why I'm asking. I see, because, you know, you're talking to somebody who's had a similar experience. I bet.
Oh, great.
It's then probably the only time in your whole interviewing career that this has happened. That's one of the reasons I was so excited about the show. But, yeah, I hear you. Go ahead.
But it was. It was just like, just say a bunch of balloons was tied to you and just lifted you off the ground. No pain, just kind of effortlessly lift you. And it seemed like we just glided with ease up to the front of the craft. Now, another thing that was going through my mind was where in the world all these lights was coming from. When I got to the door, and that's the first thing I did, was kind of roll my eyes and look around to see if I could see any light fixtures or anything. And you would think somebody being abducted and floated and levitated to a craft wouldn't even think about light fixtures.
Yeah.
But that's just how bright the lights were right there.
Well, I'm going to interrupt you for a second because we're going to just take a little break for our free Dreamlanders, and we'll be back. We're talking to Calvin Parker about his extraordinary close encounter experience in Mississippi back in 1973. Philip Mantle, the publisher of Flying Disc Press, and the new book, My Story by Calvin Parker, remarkable new vision of this experience. And also Stephanos Panayotakis from Greece, who will tell us about another witness to this who has never been discovered before. It's quite a new discovery. FlyingDiscPress.blogspot.com. You can get all of Philip Mantle's extraordinary books from Flying Disc Press, or go on Amazon or wherever books are sold. You can get My Story by Calvin Parker, very well worth your time. Calvin has been telling us a remarkable story, and Stephanos is going to be with us after the next break to do the same thing, and it's going to be very surprising. Okay, so you have been lifted up into the craft. When it happened to me, it felt like going up in an elevator that wasn't there. It was very extraordinary. So I know what happened. Now you're in, you say, in the front of the craft. Where can you exactly describe your surroundings?
Well, like I say, we come through a bad debris field. This was a mess. It was hard to even walk through to get there. So you can imagine the way that I felt just scooting through over the top effortlessly. I mean, no effort whatsoever to go, well, he was doing whatever that was doing all the work. But it was no pain. I was relaxed. So we got to the front of the craft. I kind of scouted out for the lights because they were blinding. And I was thinking, well, you know, something this bright, it's got to be some bright lights here somewhere. But I never seen nothing. It was just coming out of the walls, the lights, everywhere. So he put us in, and we kind of made a little left turn and then a little right turn. And he carried me into what I call the examination room. And I say he, I don't know if it was he or a robot. I used to call it the big ugly one. But he kind of put us in this examination room and laid me on what I figured. Now, I didn't see it because, again, I'm having to look up. And then I was at a 16-degree angle looking up at the ceiling. And that's why I didn't see the table. Somebody asked me, well, what did it lay you on? Well, I don't know because I didn't see nothing. I did feel something, you know, kind of. And it was on about a 45-degree angle. And that's when this big ugly one, as I call it, kind of backed up to the door. And there was another one. Now, I don't know if she come out. And I called it a she because it was a smaller looking, more human looking, or I can't say human, but you know, a male has a sense when he's around a female, like a female has a sense about a male. I mean, if you're a man and you go in a room, and even if a man looks like a woman, you still know it's a man some way, or if it's a woman, you kind of sense it. Of course, I've seen some that, you know, I couldn't sense that, but this thing came out, and I'm calling it a female. Now, I tried to roll my eyes and look to see if she might have floated over or walked over, but the only thing I did notice was her hands compared to the other one. The other ones had crab-like or mitten hands, where this one had fingers, and they was just a little bit longer than what human fingers are. And that's when she got and kind of grabbed me by the cheek, and I feel my cheek stinging right now, you know, in a way. It didn't hurt, but right at the time that she did that, and she run one of her fingers down my mouth and tried to come up my nasal cavity, and now that hurt, and and I was trying to come to just a little bit, and you know, I was thinking, you know, I got to get out of here. I just got to go. But then on the other hand, I was thinking, I need to take her with me. So, but then when
why
I started,
did you think that?
So I could prove what was going on. Here, here an old country boy that's never been out of Laurel, Mississippi or Jones County too much. Well, I take that back. I've been all over the world, but I never heard about abductions or UFOs or anything. And, you know, who's going to believe an uneducated country boy that's walked behind a damn mule all day?
Yeah, well, here you in at that time, you weren't alone, and nobody really knew about this at that time. I mean, in fact, when it happened to me in 1985, I didn't know about it at all either. So that was 12 years later.
Yeah, and somebody said, well, why didn't you take a picture? It's not, nowadays, it's not like it was back then.
Right,
back then,
sure
you didn't
isn't.
Have cell phones or cameras. You know, everybody carries a camera now. My cell phone's got a camera. Believe me, if it happens again and I get a chance, I will take a picture. But, you know, you didn't have social media and all this. You had three TV stations, ABC, NBC, and CBS. And the biggest thing I can heard, you know, back up to the time was about Kennedy getting assassinated. I hadn't heard nothing about a UFO landed nowhere. I didn't know what a UFO was when they started questioning me the next day when I got out. I thought
UFO. Who did question you? The sheriff, right?
The sheriff was the first one that really gave us an intent interrogation. But then, you know, that's really strange. When we got off the craft, we went to a little store because there was blue laws in the state of Mississippi. So the stores couldn't, I know people nowadays don't realize what a blue law was, but at 6 o'clock during the evening, the stores had to shut down. That was the law. You couldn't serve any liquor or anything. Now you could buy a little gas if you could find one open, but they didn't stay open because they couldn't sell nothing out of the store. So when we got out, Charlie felt the need to call somebody and tell them, Charlie, please don't do this. They ain't nobody going to believe us. They going to call us liars. And I had other motives too. I was fixing to get married in another month. I didn't want the girl I was going to marry. I didn't want her to have to explain this to her daddy because he didn't like me too much anyway. So anyhow, when we got out, we drifted on to, we got in the car and we drove up to a Magic Mart store and it was a payphone. Well, we scratched around. Neither one of us had a dime, but fortunately there had been some drop behind the seat and we got some dimes out. Charlie went and the first thing he did was call Keesler Air Force Base out of Biloxi. And he got them on the phone. Now, I don't know what they said to him. I just know what he told me they said, that they didn't do this stuff no more, didn't handle any UFO investigations. For him to call the local authorities, which would be the Jackson County Sheriff Department in Pascagoula, Mississippi. So that's what he did. He put another dime.
We now know that they've been looking into this constantly, and in fact, still are. But go ahead.
Yeah, that's true. And he called the sheriff department, and they said, well, y'all stay right there where you are. Don't move. Because I know what they thought. You know, you got two old drunk rednecks out here that said they seen a UFO, and they might get in the car and run over somebody and kill them. So they was there. I mean, it didn't take them just a few minutes to get there. Now, again, everybody asked me, well, why don't you know the times? Well, when you work in a shipyard, you sling a sledgehammer all day long and a welding machine and all. You can't wear a watch because you have it beat to death. So neither one of us had watches on. And that explains why we didn't know what time it was exactly. So when they got there, one walked up to Charlie's car, side of the car, and one walked up to mine. They kind of looked in. They asked me to step out. So I stepped out of the car, and they done what they call a field sobriety test. And I'm pretty sure, you know, that y'all might have went through one somewhere if you've been around here. But they'll pull you over, and if they think you're drinking, they get you stand on one leg, lean back, close your eyes, jump up, down, count to 10, back from 10, touch your nose. So I went through all that, and I was able to count, jump up and down, touch my nose. They said, well, you can drive. Let's go. Follow us to the sheriff department. They never would have let us follow them to the sheriff department in a car and me drive if they thought we'd been drinking. And that just wasn't going to happen. Now, I can't say I hadn't never had a drink or nothing, but back in, I really didn't. I wasn't no big drinker or nothing. You know, I drank a beer every now and then. We'd slip down to the local swim hole and put them little old Miller ponies in the water down there, keep them cold, and drink one.
Oh, yeah. I know that procedure very well myself. We're going to take another brief break here. Free Dreamlanders, keep on keeping on. We'll be right back. We're talking to Calvin Parker about his extraordinary close encounter experience in Mississippi back in 1973. Philip Mantle, the publisher of Flying Disc Press, and the new book, My Story by Calvin Parker, remarkable new vision of this experience. And also Stephanos Panayotakis from Greece, who will tell us about another witness to this who has never been discovered before. It's quite a new discovery. FlyingDiscPress.blogspot.com. You can get all of Philip Mantle's extraordinary books from Flying Disc Press, or go on Amazon or wherever books are sold. You can get My Story by Calvin Parker, very well worth your time. And Calvin, we're going to be moving on to Stephanos in just a moment. So what I would like you to do is to tell us, you received a lot of criticism. You had a lot of trouble after this happened, didn't you? In the sense that people had a hard time believing you and so on and so forth.
Well, you know, I really don't know if they had a hard time believing me, but I know at the time, I just didn't want to talk about it. It was years before I got where I can handle it. And what would really upset me and make me mad is when the press would come in to interview or want to do an interview without your permission, and then you really wouldn't give them an interview, and they would put words in your mouth and change it. And you'd look at the newspaper or see them on TV the next day, the news media, and they would make the story greater than what it was, if that's possible, or tell some kind of lie about it just to have a story there. And they never even talked to me. And that's what upset me and made me mad. If chances are, if they had been decent and just come to me and asked me to give a good interview, I probably would have sat down and done it and listened to them. But no, and that's why it was such a blessing to hear from Philip. I was wanting to do a book when this come up, but I didn't have no education. I had no help with it. You know, I had no idea how to even go about it. So when Philip and I talked, it still took me a couple of weeks of thinking about it before I really made my mind up. But when I decided to do it, I wanted to get into it wholeheartedly. And the deal was, Philip and I had, I really didn't want to edit out my part because I'd been edited all my life.
Yeah.
And Philip just left it in there the way that it was, the way I'd asked him to. And he's been great. He has been good to work with.
And
I appreciate it.
Extremely compelling. And folks, of course, you can get the book through the Dreamland Show page, and you can get it in a lot of other ways as well. But do get it, because when you read this, it'll move you. It did me. And Calvin, I want to thank you for bringing us your story. And Stephanos, who has been patiently waiting, now I think you have something to add. Stephanos, welcome to Dreamland.
Thank you for inviting me, Whitley.
Well, it's a pleasure. Right now we are I'm in California. Calvin is in the central U.S. Philip is in London, and you are in Athens.
In Athens, in a rainy Athens.
Right. Now, why are you here? Let's just start at the beginning, because after all, you're far away, and yet you've got something important to say about this.
Yes. Accidentally, I found myself in Pascagoula. I knew about Pascagoula since the day it happens there, 11th of October, 1973. I was at home, newly married, as I remember, and I saw the news on television, they say about this. And I think this story, it attracts me a lot, more than all the others I've heard since that day. And that's all, nothing else. But all the time I kept thinking about this. Later, the same year, I became a radio officer. I started to make to travel journey all around the world. And the years had passed. About 8 years after this incident, eight years after this, it was to sign on an vessel in Singapore. But suddenly everything is changed. They called me immediately to go to Barcelona to get a vessel because the radio officer there was sick. So I went there. We get the ship. We sailed from Barcelona, waiting orders. Near Gibraltar, I write the orders, and it was a big telegram, as I recall, and all the loading ports of in the USA. And one of them was Pascagoula. I told this to captain. They didn't know nothing about it. They don't know what is this, what is Pascagoula. They found it, and to make a long story short, we arrived first in New Orleans, and then we went to go to Pascagoula. We arrived there on July the 15th of 1981. It was to stay only 2 days there. I was very curious to go out and just to ask people, where is this place to go and see, nothing else. Cooperate with a Greek UFO team named Sirius, and regularly I send some my reports to a Greek UFO magazine named Astral Contact and UFO, and mostly because I was their a reporter from abroad, no, not in Greece, for. Wherever I go, I send my reports. I went to Peru and Machu Picchu, you know, in pyramids, right. In Mexico, stuff like that, nothing else. But when it was the time for me to prove something more about me. So when I arrived to Pascagoula, I thought it was a time to make a small research, nothing important, because I was not a UFO researcher. I'm just a nothing, just a simple man. But I was very lucky because when we arrived there in Pascagoula, and it was a delay for the cargo, so we had to stay 1 week. And then I said to myself, "It's your time, Stephens. Maybe you can do more things than to go there in the Sopiter shipyard and see the place where Calvin and Charlie were abducted." And started to ask people around there. First, I saw a man, Mr. Bill Rippey. He came on board to see the captain for some things, I don't know for what reason. And I approached this man, I say, I'm Stephanos, I want to make some research and investigation there. And he was very enthusiastic about this. He told me to go to his friend, Mr. Fred Ross, to meet him because he was a citizen of Pascagoula, and he will help me or lead me the way to go somewhere else, somewhere more. And after this, I met this man the same day. He told me to go to the local newspaper, Mississippi Press. I went there the next day, and I met Mr. Don Brodas. He was the responsible for the incident when it happened there. He knew everything about this. He was surprised a lot because when I told him I am from Greece, you came from there. He said, yes. And what do you want to do? I want to make a research for my country, for my group. And he was so happy about this. He was very glad, very, very happy. And say, okay, Stefanos, I will help you. And really, he helped me a lot. First of all, he gave me a small paper with some names, tried to locate these people and speak with them. And he promised me, he said, he told me, Stefanos, I will try to make you an appointment with Charles Hickson, who is there, is in Pascagoula, in Gautier, exactly. So the story goes like this. The next day I went alone with a friend to the place where all happened. I took some photos and all this. And the day after, Mr. Brodas get me there to boot here and for see Charles Hickson. The man was not there. He was working in New Orleans. So it was Mrs. Blanche, his late wife. And Don explained to her that this is a man from Greece. She was surprised. And she promised to tell about to Charlie. And she suggested to meet him on Sunday, the day he was not working. And after this, someone told me about a Greek man. Oh, no, a Greek. He didn't know that he was a Greek. He was a pastor named Sigalas. Sigalas is a Greek surname, like Panagiotakis I am. So I tried to locate this man. Someone knew his place, and I found him. I went to his home and knocked the door. I found him. I say, hello, mister, I'm from Greece. He was very surprised. Hey, boy. He was 73 years old at that time. And he welcomed me, get me in his house, and it was the first time he told his story, because this man didn't want to say anything to anyone, because he was with another man, Mr. Raymond Brodas, cousin of Don Brodas, the reporter of Mississippi Press. So because Mr. Raymond Brodas had said everything what happened with them in the car, and so they saw something to Sheriff Diamond, so Mr. Sigalas didn't want so much publicity about this. And he goes withdraw himself from the story. But when I was there 8 years after, he was very, very happy about this. And he told me everything. He told me what he saw. And this proved to be a very good witness. Very good witness.
So he was an additional witness who hadn't come forward, essentially.
Yes.
Tell us what he told you.
Yes, yes. I say, what happened, Mr. Sigalas? He told me that on that particular day, he, with Mr. Raymond Broders and a woman, a young lady named Joan Hallmark, they drove to a place where Mr. Raymond used to visit every Thursday in order to preach people who cannot control their habit for alcohol. So while they went on the way, the young girl said to, Mr. Sigalas noticed a cylindrical object in the sky following the car. At first he didn't pay much attention, but the girl said to him, Mr. Sigalas, I can see something up there in the sky. You see, I told her, he told her that it might be a helicopter from the Kaiser Air Force Base. But he asked also his friend, say, Ray, what is this in the sky? It doesn't look like a helicopter. It's something, a different type of craft I've never seen in my life, with so many bright lights. They kept driving, and the object following them. At some point, at a height about 900 meters, 3,000 feet. And they arrive in a traffic light, they have to stop a red traffic light. And it is on Highway 90. And there, in this point, they have to turn towards Van Cleef, where they have to go. And the object also stopped with them, above them, dived, make a diving toward the car, and make a turn and disappear, suddenly disappear. They saw also when the craft was hover a little more lower, they saw something like a fridge. They don't know what it was, but it was a very strange object anyway. They saw it was an extension pointing at the direction of about 2 o'clock, as we say, but in the clock at 2 o'clock. It was something like a fringe, and then the object was full, very bright, and the shape was oval. They tried to understand what they see, but they didn't know. They cannot understand. And the girl said to Mr. Sigalas, "Mr. Sigalas, I think I saw God now." And he said to the girl, "Be sure of that."
Now, Calvin, let me just go now to Calvin, if I may. Before that, though, free Dreamlanders, enjoy these announcements. We're talking to Calvin Parker about his extraordinary close encounter experience in Mississippi back in 1973. Philip Mantle, the publisher of Flying Disc Press, and the new book, My Story by Calvin Parker, remarkable new vision of this experience. And also Stephanos Panayotakis from Greece, who will tell us about another witness to this who has never been discovered before. It's quite a new discovery. FlyingDiscPress.blogspot.com. You can get all of Philip Mantle's extraordinary books from Flying Disc Press, or go on Amazon or wherever books are sold. You can get My Story by Calvin Parker, very well worth your time. Calvin, you've been listening to Stephanos, and I wonder if you lived in the area also. Did you know the man whom he's talking about, who this other witness?
I did. I knew of him, and I hear that he is a great man. He used to teach the AA classes here in and for somebody who don't know what that is, that's Alcoholics Anonymous, and they would come together, and it's helped a lot of people get off of it. And that's the way that I knew from him. Not that I went to the AA classes, but I knew him personally, and he was a good man. I think he's passed away a pretty good while back, though.
Did you know that he had this experience?
He never mentioned it to me.
Never mentioned it, and now here it is. So, you know, something obviously, I mean, it was happening then, and I believe of course, I might add, folks, by the way, that this is all in the book, which is very comprehensive. And, you know, when you read it, you come away changed, because it's sort of like reading communion in a way, because then you, my book at least, because then you look and you think, this is happening, or it did happen, and who are they, and where are they, and what are they? And Philip, I think it's time for me to ask you to weigh in as the investigator. What do you think was going on here? Who were they and what were they doing? Do you have any ideas about that?
It's a good question, Whitley. I mean, some people might not be aware, but not just the Greek pastor that Stephanos was talking about, but there were a number of other incidents in the area on the leading up to October the 11th. Just give you one example, and it's all in the book, but I think it was 3 or 4 days before Calvin and Charlie's encounter, two more fishermen, this time in a boat on the river, actually observed something underwater, and they watched it for about 20 minutes. They actually went and informed the Coast Guard in person, and the Coast Guard didn't just say, oh, yeah. They went out in their boat. And they saw it, and they followed this thing for about 20 minutes, And they had no idea what this thing was under the water. And they filed an official report. And thankfully, we managed to obtain all the Coast Guard documents, and they are in the book. So when you come to October the 11th, the night that Stefanos has just been talking about with Emmanuel Sagalis and his colleagues, others on the same night as well in the area, also witnessed something extremely peculiar. So if you wanted to speculate, Whitley, you could look upon that whatever happened to Charlie and Calvin that night was like the culmination of something. Things were building up, building up. Other things were seen in and around the area. And then, bang, you know, the incident happens with Charlie and Calvin. So that seemed like the culmination of something. What that something is completely open to debate and speculation, of course. But then, as a UFO researcher, if you take a broader look at what was happening in the United States that year, then it's probably the last great wave of sightings that hit the United States was in fact 1973. And Pascagoula was right in the center of this, right in the mix, right in the scrum. You know, we play rugby here, we have scrums. It was right in the scrum of it. And it stands out, you know, head and shoulders from a lot of the other sightings that year. But that seemed like the peak, if you like, of whatever was happening. I don't know.
But of course, it's always possible that there were sightings, I mean, things that happened that went completely unreported. Because, we're literally talking about one right now.
Absolutely. We always hope when we publish anything like this that others may come forward. We know it's a long time ago, but it's not impossible. And lo and behold, this is exactly what happened with Stefanos. As a researcher, he contacted me. He started about his research there in 1981, unraveled. He told me about Mr. Sagalis. We're going to publish his book that he wrote at that point. But I've also been contacted privately by one or two others that have come forward as well. And they've said, you know, I never told anybody at the time. I was only young, you know. Who was going to listen to me? Who do you tell in the first instance, Whitley? I think you pretty much had a similar problem yourself in 1985. When these things happen, who do you turn to? You know, there is no Ghostbusters. You know, we can't look somebody up in the telephone directory. So, that did happen. You know, other information came out of the woodwork that we'd no knowledge of, and that includes Stefanos. So purely from a research point of view, I think we're vindicated in publishing Calvin's book, because it's, when we speak to Stefanos, it's added some more information to the case in general. And we're hoping still, you know, the book's still selling, and Calvin's doing, you know, a lot of media at the moment. So we're still always on the lookout for others to come forward and say, you know, I remember that night and this is what I saw. So, you know, if anybody has, please contact us.
Yeah. And how would they contact you?
Well, you know, my name's pretty well known online. You can easily find Philip Mantle or Flying Disc Press, you know.
And you can also, folks, if you do want to contact him, you can also always write Whitley at Strieber.com and we'll forward it right along. So, Philip, now, where do we go from here? You have brought this incident back to the surface. And I have to ask you the question, what do you think is going on? It seems clear that these are people from somewhere else, whether another planet or not, of course, we can't know. But I want to ask you first what your feeling is about what might be going on. And then, Calvin, I want you to think about this while we're listening to Philip, because I'm going to ask you what you think, what happened to you, what comes to your mind about what happened to you, what it meant to whoever was doing it. Why were they doing it? And I know neither of you can give me exact answers, but I just want your kind of gut about it.
You know, my ideas have changed down the years, Whitley. The more I learned, the more they changed. But You know, the way I look at it now, and I've been speaking to a number of people, and that whatever this phenomenon may be, I get to thinking that it's something that is beyond us at the moment, that perhaps we as a species are just not capable of understanding it. The answer could be staring us in the face, but on an evolutionary scale, if you like, we're still too dumb to notice what it is. So I think the jury's out in that respect. What I will say is, I don't think it's anything that's of a natural phenomena here on Earth that causes these encounters. You know that as well as I do, probably a lot better than I do. And, you know, it's the way I look at my job, if you call it a job, Whitley, is that as an investigator, I look upon the best thing I can do is to document information like this, no matter where it comes from or who tells me these encounters, and add that to the overall amount of literature that's available, in the hope that someone with more brains than I can make some sense of it, either today or tomorrow or at some point in the future. Pretty much like, you know, not that long ago, the amateur astronomers would go on the record and talk about, you know, rocks falling from the sky, which they all knew at that time was impossible. But we know now rocks do fall from the sky, meteorites and so on. So, but had they not documented it, it may have been many decades or even centuries before that knowledge entered into our accepted science. So I think the best way I can help is just to document as much of information as possible, and then allow others to speculate, put forward theories, and hopefully, you know, one day say, aha, you know, a eureka moment. This is what it is, and this is what's happening.
Right.
And I hope I live long enough to see that day.
Calvin, one of the things you mentioned was the sense that this being, the one that wasn't robotic, was a woman, female. You know, I had exactly the same thing when I had my encounter in 85. In fact, the original painting I had made of this being that's on the cover of my book, Communion, is, I'm looking at it right now. It's 2 feet away from me, hanging on the wall.
Do you have a copy of that picture online so later on I can pull it up and look at it?
Oh, sure. Listen, just go to Google Images and put in Communion image, and hundreds of copies of it will show up immediately.
That'd be interesting to look at the picture to see if it even resembles what I was talking about.
It will somewhat. I'm aware of the fact that it will somewhat. But let me ask you this, but I'd love for you to do that. I certainly would. Let me ask you this. Did you have any sense of any emotional feeling or anything, any sense of relationship with her at all?
Well, it was strange. I really didn't feel like she was going to do any harm or anything like that, and that she cared about what happened, about my well-being. But then on the other hand, I had a sense of fear that just scared the living hell out of me. And, you know, I just wanted to reach up and get it over with, strangle her. But no, you know, it's hard to go through these emotions and really say something. I feel like in a way that we might be kind of like they might be experimenting with us, like lab animals or something. And I don't agree with that, but I think later on, you know, who knows what they're up to? I sure don't. I'm just speculating. But I think that they're trying to get to Earth where we could all kind of coincide and live on it. And I believe all the evil, they're going to kind of wash it out and get rid of it. And, you know, only pretty good people will be left, and we got to get around. Because this world is in for a heap of hurt. Everybody knows that.
Oh, yeah, we all know it now. The ones that are saying it's not happening and it's going to happen, they're liars. I mean, at first they were confused. Now they're actually lying. So we have come to the end of our time together. This is a perfectly wonderful book, My Story, Calvin Parker. And I, Philip, I would like to thank you for all of the work you did to make this happen. And of course, you, Calvin, for coming forward in the first place. Because remember, folks, once Calvin was really alone with this, just the two of them, and facing sheriffs and a lot of confused, curious people, who some of whom were not very nice about it, but he persisted, they persisted. Yeah, you know, and you're still here, by God. And you know, if this hadn't been something that really happened to you, you wouldn't still be here. But you're just just like the rest of us. We're not going to let it go.
You're right about that. I feel like it's going to be something, maybe not good come out of it, but something better than what we got going on come out of it. It's just really hard to say what's happened. I'll be the first to say, I don't know.
Well, thank you very much for being with us, all three of you. It's been a real pleasure on Dreamland to have this. And it's a kind of historical document as well, because I think it's the first time two close encounter witnesses have talked together face-to-face about this incident, and the first time you've ever been interviewed by another one of us people who got got into trouble in the middle of the night by a very unexpected way. Thank you all for being with us.
True.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander. Thank you for listening.